needs for the application, and I realized how cool it was that he was actually building a solution for a problem, and I decided that, you know, maybe I would try to go on the software development side and become a part of the solution rather than become a solution provider.
So that's why you need to do it. Just make that a little small, short.
Shorter?
The workflow you have, you could do it like something like doing again and again.
Mm-hmm.
So it could be a software that can do that.
Yeah.
That makes you want to do
it. Oh, okay.
All right.
Okay.
Who's next? So I'm going to do it. Hi, everyone. My name is Bob Monsalve. I'm a freshman in computer science. And
like I said, I'm a graduate.
I've worked in IT for 40 years. And this is guys, so it's a great time for you.
Hi. Hi, Nassim.
CNBC here.
Yeah.
You're going to be the first one.
Yeah, we're going right now.
You're going to be on national television soon.
And it's a custom.
I don't know how to spell that merchandise company.
Merchandise, D-I-C.
Well, I know it doesn't matter. I'm just saying it.
Okay.
Is that okay?
It's a custom merchandise company.
Yeah. Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wait, Benny, do you want to come over here and, like, we need to hook this up?
Oh, no, because Jeff said he's going to present first, whatever he's going to introduce.
Oh, okay.
Production.
So
and then he'll unplug his HDMI cable, which is right here. Then I'll plug it into mine, and that will be your right.
I'm going to speak from the podium because they said that they're doing it this way, and they want us to speak from the podium. Okay. So I don't know if you just want me to work this or if you want to work it.
That's fine. You can do it with the mouse or this one. Just start from the beginning, whatever. And I just go and whatever, and then.
And just click all the way there.
It's easier for you with the key. It's easier.
Yeah,
like this?
Yes.
You know, like this? It's
yeah,
easy.
Either way.
Yeah. Left and right. When you get the last
one. Once you get to this blank one,
stop it.
Stop it right there.
Yeah.
Just escape.
Just
leave it.
Just leave it.
That's after this one.
And then,
cool.
Then listen.
Okay.
If my computer screws up, start showing these. And I can explain these. I have to put all the stuff in there. Boom. Shakalaka.
If there's a problem, we'll listen to it. Like there's a problem with VirtualBox, and like we knew that this might happen, but it's like the only way that we could present. So we took some screenshots for you guys so that we can walk through and just kind of tell them exactly what's going on.
Okay.
Yeah.
Like it's
light
green and then light blue.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter.
Okay.
It's
fine.
So you're going to work on my virtual box, and I'm going to show the code. Yeah.
Give me your virtual box. Everything's
ready. You want to show it?
Yeah, sure. It's here or here?
It's right here. That's Jeff's.
He's going to do the introduction.
What's our password? The password.
What's the name for this? Welcome.
What is the
capital W capital C underscore 101?
I need the name of the network. one?
Wi-Fi. KYC Wi-Fi. What's the name of this?
TIC Wi-Fi?
No. Let me type it.
Welcome.
Yeah, with a capital C.
We have them.
Do you have a Wi-Fi here?
It's good.
Be sure of Wi-Fi.
Put it in your pocket so no one can see it. Just kidding. I don't want to ruin this shirt. It's expensive.
No, they're just not letting me contact them.
Let me ask.
You're going to start talking.
Yeah, I wouldn't say it's super important.
Do you know what network?
Yes, it's ITS.
Yes,
yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Wi-Fi?
Not sure.
Okay.
All right. So you guys are going to come up here and introduce everything.
Yeah.
So you guys will sit down the time they come stand up.
Yeah.
Welcome to Demo Day.
They have the fun, actually.
I'm only going to be here for a few minutes, so I'm going to shoot your presentation and one other. So
oh, yeah. No, I'm staying for that, though.
On, like, the next few
So minutes. I'll just kind of, I'll stand right.
Cool.
Yeah, upstairs.
Awesome.
They can hear it upstairs.
You're good.
Can hear everything upstairs?
Okay. There's lots of people in my eyes.
It's TSC Wi-Fi.
Do you want us to stand up here with you, or
sit on the phone?
No, you guys should sit for the first, because we're going to do the movie first.
How is it?
It's awesome.
Okay. Right there. Those two.
Yep.
You can meet them afterwards if you like the building, like to meet my whole team.
Just go, if you want to add an order, do that, and just go here.
Yep.
Go back.
I've lived with them since I was like three, so.
Yeah.
I've lived with them since I was like three.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So like my parents.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I just don't delete this one because I won't be able to push that. Yeah. Just go, like, go down to the very bottom. This does work, so we can go.
Yeah, it feels good. It feels really good. It's demo day. It's demo. Well, oh, I didn't bring my glasses down here. I didn't bring them down here. No. It's demo day. It's exciting. Congratulations on finishing.
I don't. It doesn't do that.
I mean, we stuck it out at the beginning. I'm not gonna lie.
It's
pretty difficult.
Go here.
Wait a minute. Is this the old? Scroll down a little bit. Scroll down. Wait, can you go to the SNS afterward, please? Scroll down. Just scroll down a little bit because I want to see like if it's the same. Okay, that's cool. And you have to wait for a sec for the price because it's. Data problem.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
I gotta get myself one of those hats. This is a nightmare.
Just try snit one right now.
Hi, Chloe.
Cool, yeah, it works. Okay. I'm gonna change.
It's demo day. Let's get jobs. Let's get jobs. Nice. And you're gonna.
You guys are both on both camera on the live stream right now.
There's no problem with anyone. Just let me know. So
yeah. Is that our voice too?
Huh?
Our voice is good?
Yeah, you guys are just being nice meeting in.
Okay.
So just hears us right now talking?
Yeah.
Sweet. Hey, live stream.
What are you guys doing?
I'm just letting you guys know.
Yeah. Don't say anything retarded.
We're on the live stream right now, so say hi. Say hi. Say hi, everybody.
Okay,
this is our Team Phun developer team.
So thanks, everybody, for coming out. I really appreciate it. I'll kind of just give you the format. So every pitch is going to be 8 to 10 minutes. There's 7 pitches. And then directly after, that'll be 70, 80 minutes, right? And then we'll go up to the 11th floor, and we'll all have pizza and beer up there. And so we're going to actually hold all the questions after the presentations, which is a little different than how we've done it before. So instead, we actually have some panelists up here who, I'll introduce them. So,
ladies first,
obviously. So, Mary is actually the, I want to say global director of talent, is that right?
No, but I like that.
Let's go with that. And do you want to kind of give a brief overview of what Mindera is and what they're...
So I'm the managing director in the U.S. Global would make me a much bigger job than I actually am, so thank you, which means I get paid more. But we're a hardcore software firm. So we build software systems that empower businesses, is our tagline. Burger King, Pizza Hut, e-commerce, ordering, high performance teams. We have about 160 engineers in several locations across the world.
Awesome. Thank you. And... Team, I'll just let you describe yourself because I know that's like one of your favorite things to do.
Easy way out. I forgot my headphones.
No worries.
I'm Etienne de Bruin, founder of a company called 7CTOs, focused on developing aspiring software engineers into future chief technology officers. We also work closely with existing CTOs to work inside of forums to process issues and challenges within their companies, i.e. their CEOs. No response. So very excited to be a part of this, Jeff. Thank you. And I also love building software projects and see what happens.
Awesome. And we actually have a third panelist, Ben. You know how it is when it rains in Southern California. So he'll be here in just a second. He's actually the CEO and founder of a software company as well here in San Diego. So he'll jump in as soon as the first pitch starts. So before we get started, I just wanted to kind of play out. I created a 5-minute video to kind of give you guys some context of what goes into these demo days. So everything up here, right, you'll get like an 8 to 10 minute pitch, but there's a lot more that like, goes on behind the scenes. And this was one of the first, it was really the second time, I believe, that we had employers or small businesses in San Diego pitch to the students projects that they needed built for their final projects. And then the students actually got to pick who they partnered with to build those projects. So we actually have some real world applications and people will actually be using the software the students built for their final project. So I just wanted to play this real quick to give you guys some insight on that.
It's very gratifying because as someone who's been a professional developer for 17 years now, I know the difference. for students of what it's like to be a professional developer. My history with Origin Academy is quite compelling. I happen to have hired someone out of this program about a year ago now, and he is incredible. People really want to solve problems when they come out of Origin, and that's why I decided, you know what, let me pitch a challenge that I find, you know, I'm a coder, and I find the challenge to be pretty daunting, and especially when I found out it's only 3 weeks, I decided, oh well, you know, I'm going to pitch them and see if they can rise to the occasion, and once again, I'm just amazed at the presence, the proactive communication, the just the gratitude for working with someone.
Well, so I'm the operator. We're at the volume, which is on the same floor as Origin. So we see your stuff in the bathroom on the wall for the day, and you know, you just get to know one another for all the
same.
The biggest advantage is just time on our side to do it. So we always have more projects on our list than we can do ourselves. So this is a nice way to extend our capabilities. We purposely picked a project that we thought would be a good project for one of your students. So we tried to keep it more simpler, things that we want to do, but also something that's engaging, a complete product that they can own and really, you know, learn an end-to-end process.
We had a client attorney come to us, wanted to give better access to his clients as well as other clients have better access to him. It's a need that most attorneys and clients see on a day-to-day basis, updating court cases, information between the two, as well as document management.
I think it's cool to solve a problem for somebody that needs something to maybe enhance their business and make them more money. I just think it's cool to solve a problem.
I'd say the biggest challenge overall was learning a little bit more about a different stack that we learned in the curriculum process. Usually we go through on the back end with a C# and SQL database, and for this one we went with Mongo and Node.js, so a full new stack. And I would say that was a bit of a challenge as far as getting started, knowing what is exactly going on with these things.
The main reason why I chose this project was twofold. First being that it solved a real world problem. Two, there were several components to this project that were new. So going into it, I wanted to not only learn something, but then actually complete it and tackle that challenge.
I chose it because it was an opportunity to do a project for an actual company, and there was a challenge behind it that I wanted to tackle, which was the real-time chat card.
Do you guys feel like you have your project done completely now?
If we don't see
of course, there's always these last minute that come up. We find bug fix right now. We last minute advice, change things around. So we're stressing.
But 48 hours are definitely like the heart rate's a little bit going up there, and you gotta have to like just be in front of a bunch of people. So it's definitely not the most relaxing time.
I'm feeling good. I feel like I'm going to be really tired in 48 hours, but that's not nothing complicated. Mm-hmm.
Next 48 hours,
I'm not stressed out about finishing my project. I'm more concerned about how it will be in front of the audience.
Okay. I feel very positive, actually. Just need to hammer down, get these last couple functions down, and should be good to go.
It'll be a long night.
Yeah, I mean, you just know that you're seeing, like, trying to share issues, heading towards success. And that's a wonderful feeling. It really warms your heart. And you see, there's always these moments where you're like, oh my God, how are we going to do this? How are we going to get this done? Where you have these moments of doubt, but you basically just focus on the end point and you take a step back occasionally. And you see that, you know, it is all going to happen. It's all going to work out. That lives my peers to be rational. And I have a great team of students here, and you're all working. And they're all very dedicated to it. And I think they're also doing this in a really kind and really job. We have a lot of good support from the rest of the company here. So
mention is if you have a specific question for one of the projects, when we get food up on the 11th floor and after the presentations, that'll be your chance to kind of go to their specific table or area and then kind of pick their brains on those particular projects. So with that, Ben just got here, so come on up, man. Hey, no worries. Actually, if you want to give us a little bit about your company, just so we have some background on you. I know putting you on the spot the moment you stepped in the room.
Oh, that's all right. I just got here 2 seconds ago. Hi, everyone. I am Ben Nowacki. I am the CEO of Three Screen Studio. We're a local software development shop in North County, and I'm excited to see what you guys have done.
Awesome.
Quick and easy.
With that, we'll have our first team come on up.
How's it going, everybody? We are the Team Phun developer team. Team Phun is a local San Diego business, which basically customizes merchandise that you want. They do some really cool stuff. They're right here, if you guys want to see them. We're going to go through our team and say a little bit about ourselves. So I'm Tristan Ewing. I'm 20 years old. And prior to finding Origin Code Academy, I had just finished my first year of college, and I felt kind of stuck because I felt like I was learning absolutely nothing. And I was always really into problem solving and puzzles and stuff like that. And my friend was like, why don't you go to a coding boot camp? And I was like, they have those. Okay. I was like, where do I want to work? Obviously in beautiful San Diego. So I typed in coding boot camps in San Diego, and it was just Origin, 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 Origin. I was thinking either Jeff is paying somebody a lot of money to get him on the top of Google, or this place must be pretty good. And we're on demo day now. I've had a fantastic time, and I can't wait to start looking for jobs.
I'm Marcy. I have worked in, a little bit about me is I've worked in finance over 10 years. I worked in the corporate world, and the reason why I was interested in learning how to code is I actually worked alongside a software developer to create two applications. So I worked on the logic part and explaining what the problem was, but I saw what he did in creating the solution. So I really wanted to be a part of that, but I never really thought that I would be able to have the opportunity. So when I learned about Code Academy, Origin Code Academy, I just jumped on the opportunity. So I'm grateful to be here.
Hi, everyone. My name is Bahman Sadiq. I have a bachelor in computer science. I went to college to learn programming. I did an app in a work at an IT for 4 years. And when I heard about Origin Code Academy and saw their syllabus with the teaching, that inspired me to join Origin Code Academy. I had a basic understanding of programming, but I wasn't able to make any project work. So today I'm very happy I have the skill set and can make something good.
Hi everyone, how's everybody doing? A little bit about myself. My name is Benny Largo. I also have a background in information technology. It's more on the hardware side. I never had the opportunity, had zero coding experience. So this is the missing piece of the puzzle from my background. I finally got an opportunity to, and here we are on demo day. Thank you.
All right. So we're going to go through some slides with you guys real quickly before we get to our demo. So first of all, our problem being solved. Limited accessibility. So Sean, the owner of Team Phun, he's got to quote people on how much it's going to cost them to like get his shirts and stuff like that. And if he's on the road or he's out to dinner, he's very busy. I know he's always going all over the place. He can't do that with the system that he had before. So the time-consuming process is the system of Excel. And I don't know if anybody's worked with Excel. I assume so. But we can build something better. And so it was time-consuming for them. They had to manually type everything in. They had to do all that stuff by himself. They couldn't do it mobily because they needed their Excel sheets at their work. And the third one is just being fast and efficient helps companies grow. And I think that's just like the mindset that we had going into this. We were like, how could we make them faster and better so that they could spend their time doing different things that might help them instead of this Excel. So why we chose this project? We wanted to help out a local San Diego company. We're looking for jobs in this market, and it seemed like the right thing to do at the time, and it still seems like the right thing. grow their business by speeding up their workflow. So basically, we wanted to make an algorithm that just automatically calculated their stuff for them, so they don't have to spend any time going through all these numbers and stuff like that. Third one is to utilize the skill set that we had learned in 12 weeks. This project couldn't have been more perfect for what we had been taught at Origin Code Academy. Literally, all the technologies we used were perfect for this. And this is just a little example of our technology stack. On the front end, we have HTML5, CSS3, JavaScript, and Angular. And on the back end, we have ASP.NET, Web API 2, C#, Entity Framework, and SQL Server.
I'm just going to switch computers real quick. Sit there with us. So since I have a Mac, we're using VirtualBox, so unfortunately the view is a little small. I apologize for that. But this is our application. Go ahead and start from the beginning. Okay, so when you come in, it's just a general hello, like welcome to Team Phun. Team Phun is the business that we're working with. When you start out, this is Team Phun's admin program, so it's not computer, it's not customer facing. So the workflow is basically what you need to do is add a customer, and once you add the customer to the database, you're just going to basically fill out the fields, and then you can also put a note. It's going to come up, and we'll have it in here, and then you also can, you could look for the customer, you could search for the customer. And if you have a problem like where you need to edit the customer's information, like their phone number or their address, or you want to see a more detailed view than what the table shows, we have that option here as well. So it's kind of like a client management system here. Yep, and so once you update it. So then once you create your customer and then you... you want to pick your customer, and what you want to do is add an order. So he's a Windows user and trying to navigate on my computer. So that's the thing. Okay. So once you add the order, it's going to take you to the quote calculator, and you go ahead and pick the client that you want to build an order for, and it creates an order number for you at the top, and you could say what the product is, like T-shirts. And then you could say what the price is per item. So usually that's like a blank product, maybe like a mug that they're going to do a cool thing on, or T-shirts. The total pieces in order. So this is basically is doing the algorithm for you on the side, and it's real time calculating each piece, what each piece has and how it will add up. And then the big piece that I think that Sean would agree with me is Sean is from Team Phun, is he really wanted to be able to figure out the profit margin, have a sliding scale so he could see the total and stay within budget for his client. So go ahead and show them the sliding scale for the profit margin. Bahman? Go up. Slow and show that part. Yeah. So as you go, you can see like the profit margin getting bigger or smaller. And you can see, oh, am I going to make money? Is this even going to be worth it for me to do? Or are they going to stay in budget? And how much am I going to make? So this is a great tool for them to be able to use and see real time before, like, actually submitting their project, their order. Okay, so once you submit your order, it will go down the table here. You have plenty, like a lot of order line items. Some of this data is just test data, but you can have t-shirts, and then you have an order line of t-shirts and the final product for that. Then you can have like hats and another line, and then everything you place an order for that is one order. And then, so then that would be that order. And then you can go to the orders table, or the order page, and what the order page does is allows you to update order, like total price, if you have some changes that go on in there. So we have that editability function. And you could also delete an order, like let's say they call and say, I found a better vendor or something like that. That would never happen, because Team Fund's the best. But if they do, you know, you could cancel them. And you could also delete them from your database if you wanted to. Okay, so the other thing that we added was SNS Activeware. SNS Activeware is an API that, actually it's a vendor that Team Fund uses to buy most of their like product, like their blank product. So what we have right now is a search function, so you can search and you can see the product. You can see like the case price, the average case price, the style ID, and get an idea. I mean, if you want to go into construction, like this is a business for you to contact. but yeah, so this is another feature. So if he's talking on the phone with his client and he wants to get an idea of something that they might want, that this is something that we could do. So.
Who doesn't want a mesh working vest?
So yeah, that's like in general our project. And can you show them how it's responsive?
Might be kind of hard on VirtualBox, but yeah.
Yeah, I can
show
this. It's not impossible. Okay, so we made it so that like if
your mobile phone.
So if you're on your phone, you're anything at dinner or anything like that, you can use this.
Yeah, you can go to orders or whatever thing you need to go to, and then you can just go from there. So when you're out driving around, you can do your quote like you want it to.
Yeah, it's highly responsive.
We're not promoting using your cell phone and driving, but you can do it if you want to.
Okay, so yeah, that is our project.
That's our project.
And we had like 3 weeks to complete this.
Yes.
Yeah.
Just to add, this has been a tremendous burden on the business, like we mentioned. It's just been a time-consuming thing, and the faster we can get estimates out to our clients, the happier they are. The faster those estimates turn into orders, the faster we can go into the next estimate and make more money. Obviously, you know, we're always working within the constraints of our clients, so some clients are going to push us on a particular order to, you know, basically take a dive on margin, and we'll do that occasionally, just depending on the relationship, and if we know we can make our money back at a later time. So it's an invaluable thing. I mean, we can't wait to start using this and really put it to the test.
Is it happening? At the beginning, we started more programming to do all of us together to make the basic structure. Then we divided by two teams. Tristan and Vinny was working on get the API from the SAS API and everything like pop up, and me and Burr and
Marcy.
working together. Then again, we split up, like even 12 of us split out the same with them. At the end of the day, we like made the comment of the changes we had and push it on our GitHub and merge it online, and not on our main branch, and a dev branch out of the main branch. And everyone pull out the updated code every day.
Really good. And we weren't working with just one API, we were working with four.
Well, it was one. It proved to be a pretty difficult towards the end, just with all the data being pulled. But.
Right. Thank you. question.
So, again, great job. I mean, your client says that they love it, so at the end of the day, that's what matters, right? My one piece of feedback was, in the beginning, you said that the problem you were trying to solve was to get them able to be able to use this while they were running around, and yet you built it for a desktop to be responsive to mobile. So I would say consider mobile first. You know, if that's what you're trying to solve, try to find a way to make it work when they're in their car speaking to it, or, you know, so that they don't crash, that kind of thing. But really great job. Responsive in terms of, like, the speed of the,
calculations.
So.
Two-way binding.
You just throwing out coding words.
Yeah.
For loops.
What was the biggest problem you guys had to solve while you were working on this project?
The API, I guess. The API was very difficult for us. Somehow, depend on the range of the product you want. Like, if you own 50 pieces, the color, two colors, this is dynamic. It changes all the time. If you increase your number of colors and increase your number of like t-shirts you want to order, the value for color, like, is dynamic, it's increase and decrease. So that was the hardest part for us to figure out how to manage the tables.
And then conversely, what was the most interesting problem you had to solve?
Honestly, I think the whole thing was interesting. It was like the perfect learning experience. Like, we didn't get to implement like everything that we wanted to just because of time crunches and bugs and stuff like that. But we really learned a lot in the process of this project. Thank you.
Just the panel.
Thank you. Thank you.
Who's up next? Let me get the dongle out. We should be good to go. Sorry. Start before. Good call. Hopefully this will work. There we go. 1 second. Sorry, technical difficulties, everybody. All right. Before we start, thanks you guys for all coming out to Cohort 6's demo day. Before we start, I definitely want to introduce myself and my team, Joe. So this is our dev team. It's going to be consisting of myself, John Abanto.
And I'm Joseph Kell. So before getting into programming, I was actually trained to be an iron worker. Did that for a couple years while working in retail at the same time. And I built a computer about a year ago, and it was probably the most interesting thing at that point in my life that I've done for a long time. And the only part of it that wasn't easy enough for me to just Google and figure out was the programming side of it. So that kind of sparked my interest into software development. Last spring, I took my first class in programming, and now I'm here presenting in front of all of you.
A little bit about myself. My name is John Abanto. I actually previously worked in the retail industry for about 10 years. Pretty successful, working in a lot of corporate stuff. But honestly, I wasn't feeling the passion in my life that I really wanted. And I really wanted to have that again. So my passion, who here had MySpace back in the days? That was my introduction to programming. And honestly, I really wanted that back in my life, that creative, artistic freedom that I was looking for. So what we started to do, as far as our project goes, is we met with a lot of
people pitching different ideas. And we got an idea from Sean and his friend, actually, Nate, who's been to one of those wine and paint events.
Yeah, right here.
He's right here. They're awesome, right? So we wanted to create him a update his page. He needed a backend to create databases to collect people, users. And then we actually really liked it, and we wanted to create it from front to back, not just the backend. And honestly, we started doing it. We got a vibe for it. And honestly, we loved it so much, we wanted to create our own. So we tweaked it a little bit, made it our own version, OK? So.
And then the tech stack will show up. So as far as a tech stack goes, just a normal modern stuff as far as Bootstrap, jQuery, some CSS. And for the tech stack, we did a full mean stack. So Mongo's database, Express and Node for the server side, Angular for the front end, and then a couple other little goodies we threw in there was Twilio integration as well as Google Maps. Right. Yeah, so without
now we're going to go ado, jump into. And so our app.
One second. And we're back. Okay.
So this is the homepage for our app. We called Eventive. Eventive is a wine and strictly for the wine and paint industry for a local company that we created to help them increase the traffic to their business, give them more of a feel for people who want to enjoy the ideas.
All right. And so it goes through with also along with like a lot of fundraising events and also corporate events as well. So we wanted to kind of give the piece of someone that's just coming into the website, and they heard about it, they wanted to sign up for an event. So they come in, they go through to the upcoming events and look into it, and they could see a couple just events pop up and see the little pieces right here of just a little bit of information, that kind of detail. And so if you scroll down, you could see that the actual events show up. And so we have just a nice little piece. Bob Ross is our host for these ones. As far as our test example.
You have that friend who always posts up awesome pictures on Instagram and you want to take, be a part of, like, she tells you, hey, would you go to that event? So they give us the address to this website. So you can go ahead and look onto it and see what you want to be a part of. Unfortunately, you can't be a part of it until you sign up and register with us. So who wants to register? Jenny, great. So we're going to go here and go to the registration page and have her sign up.
Don't make your password in real life,
yes.
Jenny, what's your phone number again? 609-349-6254. Okay.
So when she registers, it takes her to a profile page. This is the generic profile page where you can log in, enter your information. You can edit it any way you want in case you typed your email wrong. You can always upload a picture. Let's make sure she's a real profile. Jenny, there she is. So as you can see, there are no upcoming events because she hasn't signed up for any so far. So she's going to go ahead and click on the events. You can see the full list.
And then she'll be able to just come back down, hit the sign up, and it will show up back in her profile page with just a little bit of information about it and also do send the reminder so she can actually get it onto her phone rather than just having it on a static site. And hopefully her phone goes off in a second. There you go.
She got a reminder telling her, don't forget, at this time you have an event coming up. So that's for anybody who wants to take part in our events. So we're going to go ahead and switch to Bob Ross, who's going to make a new event. He heard about, he wants to make more stuff for later this week. He can create an event. So Bob Ross right here. Same base outline, but this has all the events that he has created. He can go in and edit it, make a new one.
Make a new one, yeah.
So we set it up the fields to where, you know, the time, the date, the address, any type of details you want to put about it. The level of difficulty of the piece that we're going to be creating, we have it set for novice, intermediate, advanced, or Rembrandt, depending on the level of painting that you guys want to take. So here you can check the date, you can add what time it starts, and then once you hit submit, it's going to create an event. And right there, and then he can go ahead and set a type of picture that to let everybody know this is the painting that we're going to paint at the end of our event.
And probably my favorite part about this whole thing is that they have the power for the administrator, the person that's throwing it up, mm-hmm. to send out a reminder to everyone in the room.
Yeah, as you can see, it says how many nice. People are attending. So you can keep track of your business, how many people are coming, how many people mm-hmm. are excited for this event. And then when you set a set reminder, it sends it to all of them to remind you to come.
Yeah, and a couple phones should be going off right now in the room. Most likely my family's.
There it is. Amount of attendees, like, put a limit.
Yes.
Definitely,
so you
yeah.
You can set that as much as you want. You can even remove the event to cancel it altogether.
Yeah, well, part of the
all
demo.
Right, so go back to the home.
All right, back to the home.
And that is the full-on app that we created for our local web painting company. And here's our information just in case you guys want to contact us. Thank you guys so much.
Yeah, thank you all for coming out.
The reminder, do you get a reminder like a day or two before the event?
We don't have it set up like that for automated purposes, only just for the demo piece of it. Like, it's an easy thing to write a script for just like a couple days before and then have that sent out, yeah, 48 hours.
It's so honestly said, just so organizer can send whenever he wants to remind people. If you want to bug people, you can just keep doing it. You know?
Yeah.
So it's not that easy, but mm-hmm. okay. Secondly, what SMS API did you use?
Twilio.
Mm-hmm. And then how much time did you spend on the user login sign up stuff?
It was like a pretty big task because we knew we were going to do actual like authenticated user, so that when you do go in and you do say sign in for a first time without like normal stuff, it's just going to kick you out of it if you haven't like signed in through registering an account and that kind of thing. And so we did have to work a pretty good amount.
We planned it out to tackle that big chunk about the first week. We had a pretty strict timeline mm-hmm. that kept us on week one, week two, week three. We're trying to these deliverables.
Yeah, and like the basis of that authentication was probably the basis of the entire back end. So once that was done, a lot of it was just kind of falling in line with all of that.
Very good. And then just very quickly, did you put any thought into recurring events?
I mean, one of the events that we created was Wine Wednesdays. It all really depends on the organizer, how they want to utilize the tool.
It kind of wasn't like we kind of just wanted to get like a couple core features in there before we.
I currently am using Eventbrite a lot, which is not synchronized into my site, which is frustrating, and the cost is expensive too.
Mm-hmm.
This is Nate. He was our original our client.
I'm impressed. Yeah, I am, and it's a huge market too.
Definitely, we love it. That's why we wanted to do it because we've had a lot of fun at those events.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, guys, really good job, first of all. I have a little bit of constructive criticism, so take this as you know. Because you said you really appreciate doing the design and the creative mm-hmm. part of that, I would consider that you look at your client and his t-shirt and mm-hmm. his cards and how bright and kind of festive his thing is.
Mm-hmm.
And I know this is your own app, but, you know, maybe consider that when you're really looking at your market, who's going to be using this, who's it going to appeal to, and perhaps make some design decisions based on, you know, your client probably, if he's doing well in his business, which it seems like he is, has already done a lot of that market research. So you guys can kind of piggyback on that, so you don't have to refresh that. And then the second thing is just kind of piggybacking on the login question, was there a consideration of using single sign-on, you know, Facebook, social media login, so that you already captured the picture, you already had the social kind of world there available where people are always talking.
I mean, that is a core feature that a lot of different apps we were doing, but for us, like a learning purpose, we wanted to definitely create our own, experience that, and then definitely later on integrate that into it once we scope it up a little bit more.
Mm-hmm.
together looks really good. Say client comes back to you next week and says, love it, I want to change everything. How flexible, or let's say I want to add a feature onto it. Hey, I love this, this is great. Can you run a report for me that says how many registrations I had in the last 30 days that got a text message verification? How is your code written to be able to
As far as being able to adjust depending on the client's needs, this is actually the second version of it. We've had another version. It was very similar to the original app, but we wanted to go and make it a little bit more not specifically for that, so we changed the whole theme around a little bit, the color green. It was a lot whites, pinks, and neon blues, but we changed it to this one. And then as far as like the keeping records?
Yeah, as far as keeping records goes, it'd probably take like a couple days to change as far as like that kind of thing. I know I did add some features on the back end that I didn't just have like, we just didn't have time to push it to the front. And so there is definitely like a registration check-in piece that I have in there. And it's just like hasn't had a place to be filled out yet, but time constraints and all that. So,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Can you export reports like, so for me, as far as demographics, that's like huge. I want to know who's attending the events, whether it's, you know, the age, gender, location. Can you guys
pull
the information from that? Because
yeah, like we can definitely, it'd just be adding a couple more fields in that initial registration piece. But yeah definitely like not too hard to do.
Mm-hmm. Something we can work on definitely.
Yeah. And like part of the build and why we wanted to use Mongo is we actually embedded like full on, there are like sub items within the events piece. So the events piece actually has every user info inside of it. So it'd be extremely easy for us to just like pull out all the data.
Very, very
mm-hmm. So yeah.
Thank you guys.
Thank you guys. Oh yeah, mics. Oh, you only need the one, right? One second. I have to find a cord. Be right back. And that's it. I'm out. Here. All good. Oops. There we go. Hi, guys. My name is Cam Wilcox, and I created MyGuide. So before I dive into the app, I'll tell you a little bit about myself. I'm 24 years old, grew up in Michigan.
Straight out of high school, I moved to Breckenridge, Colorado to become a professional ski bum for about 6 years until I moved here in June. And while I was there, during the off season, got a little bored about 3 years ago, so I decided I wanted to learn how to code. So I taught myself how to write in Objective-C for the past about 3 years, pulling my hair out in coffee shops and reading tutorials and whatnot. And then I wanted to kind of further my education, so I was looking for something, boot camp, something like that, and Origin came up, so I gave it a try, and it's been a wonderful experience, so much fun. But while I was being a ski bum, I also loved to travel. So I travel all around. About a year ago, I was in Europe, and I was at the Colosseum, and I was walking around, and I didn't pre-buy a tour. So I went over. There's a line for the audio tours, so I decided, okay, I'll go stand in the line, and I rented an audio tour for about $12. Round two. No, it's not going to show. I don't know. Oh, okay. We saw something. Let's exit out of that. I'm sorry. Maybe something. There we go. Cool. Now that you get up and running, open up the app, log in. All right, and here you are with your blank homepage. We can go to the store. We can search by location. We'll just look at all the locations right now. Here's all the tours on the store as of now. We can go through. We can filter them by price if you'd like. What was ours? Ours was origin title. We can like them as well. Like button. Come on. Like button. Oh! It works once in a while. All right, so here we are. And we have the, I put in some dummy data for reviews just to get a good visual of what the reviews will look like since it's a new tour. There aren't any reviews. You can get all the information you need right there. Download it. And it saves it to your phone's core data for 7 days. So if you don't have a data plan, you're able to go to a Starbucks, find free Wi-Fi, download a tour, and then be able to listen to it at your location. Just go here for the tour, click on a point. You see the detail there. Then we can play it.
Let's say about that point.
Then we go to the second point.
And then right here we can record some audio. Hopefully we can play it back.
And the one thing that everyone does while they're on a tour is you swipe up anywhere on the screen and you have your camera available. Take a picture.
And it saves it right into your photos. And when you're done with the tour, you press end, you can give it a rating. Give us a 1-star because we messed up so much.
That's it. So that is MyGuide.
Yeah, so I'll go first.
Yeah.
I have to say, I really like the way you think. So when we look for engineers to hire onto our teams, especially a junior engineer who's coming in, new to the industry or whatever, one of the main things we look for is how do they solve problems? How do they think about problems? And then how do they go about solving it? So irregardless of the technical difficulty, it doesn't matter, right? We have them all working. Yeah, that just happens all the time. So I really like that. I like the idea you saw something that you experienced in your real life and you tried to figure out a way to fix it. So that's really cool.
Yeah, thank you.
The whole idea about line busting is what we call it in my world, which is how do we get people past the line, like to consume something faster so they don't have to wait in line.
Yeah.
Awesome. We were thinking about that in this way, I think it's really cool. A couple points. I love single sign-on. I don't know if technologically that's single sign-on is bad, but like if you're going to use photos, if you're going to use starring systems, why not just have them sign on into a world that already uses that, like say Facebook or Yelp or TripAdvisor or something like that, where they're already there.
Yeah, you could definitely integrate that.
One of the problems I think they would want to solve is how, when you get to Notre Dame, say some type of geolocation service or something that uses a service that's already on the phone.
Yeah.
But somehow pings them and says, hey, did you know this app?
Something that's maybe Wi-Fi because you want to be offline the whole time, not to use data. But yeah, so that's a really good idea. Awesome. Thank you.
How long did you have to do the whole thing?
About 3 weeks.
So let's say things just went absolutely crazy. It's only taking you 6 full weeks to do this.
Yeah.
What's the next big feature you would add on to this?
Well, I'd like to really make the user, from the user's perspective, right now it's just one line. You know, you go and you buy tours, everything. I want to be to have you be able to save tours, you know, like flag this one. I'm going to go on a trip in a week. I want to flag this so I can easily pull it up and download it right away. Just more making more of a profile, making it easier to contact the guide. So it's like, I love this tour. I want a one-on-one tour. I want to actually ask questions to a guide. Let me contact them. So just it wouldn't be anything huge. It'd be more of all the little details that you can use along with this to just make it great. Thank you.
Yeah, I thought you did a great job. I don't know if you know the game Hearts, where you have to, I think you shoot the room or something.
Yeah.
And sometimes you get there, you know, quite easily, and sometimes you just need one or two cards and you just kind of lose the whole game.
Uh-huh.
So that's what happened for me. I think you started off great. I felt like you just tried to do just too much.
Yeah, bit off a little bit more than I could chew, but tried to pack it all into the
thing. You're obviously a talented guy. I agree. You obviously solve problems in your brain. You go after that. I think it's awesome. If I had to put my hiring hat on, I would have some concerns about how the demo went, how much, you know, scoping out what was achievable inside of 3 weeks.
Yeah.
And then how to present that in a way that conveys trust. Brilliant,
definitely.
Talented guy, wonderful attempt at solving this,
mm-hmm.
but you know, just kind of fell short for me a little bit. So.
Exactly. Cool. Thank you.
Very cool.
Thank you. Thank you. Did I drop some microphones or something?
Mute is off.
Thank you.
Testing. Check. All right. Is there a director or do I just go?
You are the director.
I am the director. All right. Good afternoon. My name is Jeff Lommer, and I chose to do the Shopify app project. Just by a show of hands to see how much depth I need to go into. Who's ever heard of Shopify in the first place? Okay, that's good. All right, and the client that I'm working with is Obrary. I'm probably going to use a few words that might not make a lot of sense at first.
I'll try and explain the best I can. When I first approached this project, it took me a couple days to try and get my head wrapped around all the details. So Obrary is a product configuration software company. And really basically what that means is if there's a product being sold on Shopify, they have an additional plugin that allows that merchant to have their people who come to their website personalize the products that they're purchasing, and they can do it real time. So they know if they're personalizing some kind of project, whether it be a tote bag or a gift for a best man at a wedding, they know exactly what it looks like. And they can do all the work themselves, and it's saved to the exact file that the person who's printing or etching these products actually uses. It cuts out a lot of the steps in the process. And using Shopify themselves, they came across a problem that they wanted to solve. And that's the project that I picked to do. But before we get to that, we are forced to talk a little bit about who we are. So my background has nothing to do with computers. I didn't even really touch a computer until I was a freshman in college. And I went to the United States Military Academy. And after 4 years there, I had the luxury of traveling the world and meeting new people. And I did that for 12 years. So from the time I was 18 until I was 30, I was in the Army. And I really liked it. It was a very challenging job. I did a lot of exciting things. But as I was approaching 30, I kind of realized that it wasn't sustainable. I had several brain injuries, and I have arthritis in my back, and I've had accidents and combat injuries, and I couldn't do it anymore. I wanted to go back. I wanted to settle down somewhere in the United States, and I picked San Diego because, to me, it's the greatest place in the world. So I moved to San Diego, and first thing I did was I worked in finance for 3 years until I couldn't do it anymore. My entire career had been somewhat altruistic, and going into finance, I just never really enjoyed it. I couldn't find a mentor. I couldn't see anybody who was maybe 10 to 20 years older than me that I could pick and say, I want to be that person. So I started investigating starting my own company. And I started kind of putting things together, and I wanted to launch this company called Denali 2 Media. In doing so, in my business plan, I started researching how to set up a website. I wanted an e-commerce website that I could be able to sell products to over the internet. And this was maybe 2 years ago, and I was shocked to learn that for a custom e-commerce website, you can spend up to $25,000. Or much more than that, depending on how many features or what kind of functionality you want in this website. But, I mean, that just blew my mind. I was kind of a lot in my business plan. I was like, it might be $2,000-$3,000. Not $25,000. So I started kind of looking into it. Well, I could probably do it myself. You know, I'm pretty okay with computers, but I never written code. And I started looking at it and was like, wow, that's way too much for me to handle. And that's when, it was about a year ago, I started looking into boot camps like this. Just because in my background, I have a lot of the soft skills, the leadership experience, and a lot of things that I did, and a lot of things that don't really translate well being an infantry guy in the Army. So I wanted to pick up some tangible skills. So I thought that this was a great idea. So that led me into that. So speaking of e-commerce websites, Shopify is the leading e-commerce platform, I think, in the world. It has the largest market share. So what a better way to learn than to pick this project. This is the landing page when you go to Shopify.com. It's an e-commerce platform made by you. That's the tagline. And if you are a merchant and you choose to use Shopify, you're paying a recurring fee monthly to use that service. And if you were to sign up and just get Shopify, you get the bare bones vanilla version of that platform. the way they kind of get you, and I don't want to turn this negative, but you go into the app store and you buy apps. And these apps then add more functionality and more customization to your website. So there's several apps on the Shopify app store. And the goal of this project was to create a real-world app to put in the Shopify app store. When I first met with the CTO at Oberry, there was kind of the basic pitch, and then I decided I really wanted to do it. And so we sat down, we had a discovery meeting, and we went through some of the needs analysis. And that's the actual kind of mock-up as I was taking notes. So first off, the biggest thing that I wanted to define was the problem. And the problem was that the native Shopify content management tools have limitations. So if we were to create our own app, that we would be able to evaluate and modify the custom content based on what the owner of that store wanted to modify on their product pages. So for example, a key function, this is an actual product on Shopify. And here you have some unique product info about this 50 caliber bottle opener. And I didn't pick this because I was in the military, it's just an example. So one thing that this app will be able to allow the merchant to do is save time, because they can go in. This is a product that's going to cause concern during travel. So the TSA doesn't want you to travel with this big 50 caliber bullet. So if you wanted to add that information to your product page, basically what the app does is it's going to go through and it's going to parse through all of the information in the database that all of these thousands of products that most vendors have. And anytime certain things match, if you set up a rule and you say, if this product contains the word bullet in the title, I want you to add a little blurb at the bottom saying, we strongly recommend that you do not travel with this product on your person or in a carry-on bag. Kind of makes sense, right? So some of the common scenarios to add a little blurb would be like that, maybe a legal warning. If it's an alcohol product, must be over 21 to buy. Shipping time or shipping concerns. If the product weighs over 50 pounds, it will not ship to a residential address. And when you start doing this, it can be very time-consuming if you did not have this app. So if you have 1,000 products and maybe 400 of them have similar things, you would have to go through to every single one of these different products and type all these things in yourself. Our goal was to use this app so you can edit that text in one page. It would go through all the products and, 2 minutes left. Well, that's cool. So we set up a Trello board trying to set up our software development process. These are the technologies that we used. It's kind of a little bit lesser known. It's an AND stack, so it's Angular, Node, Neo4j, and Express. Neo4j is a newer graph database that we hadn't touched before. So I had to go through and kind of learn that just to get started. It's a very cool graph database. And it kind of does these relationships that's very similar to the way your brain actually works. If you're confused, bear with me. So we set up a rules engine, kind of like what I was talking before. We have several fields that you're going to go in. You're going to name the rule. That rule is going to be part of a larger set. You're going to have a priority for that. So maybe there's a couple of these blurbs that are getting injected. One's more important than another. You're going to have maybe a product title is equal to and a value. And that value is either going to be Boolean, numeric, or text. And once all of those, if that's satisfied, you're going to inject whatever blob that you have down here at the bottom. And that can be text or it can be HTML. So here we come to our merchant page. You sign into Shopify as a business owner. You come here. And this is kind of like behind the scenes, the code, where you'd be able to go in and inject the app.
So now I'm going to jump into the demo really quick. So this is an ongoing project, and in the time allotted, we were able to push through to phase one. And phase one was to be able to write the code, get it into an app inside of Shopify, and be able to push some of this data. So if we say rule test, pick one of the sets, priority, we'll say contains alcohol, that's text, must be 21 to purchase. So then we would submit that rule. And this is our table that stores, it's kind of showing, this is the user interface, and when you come to this, you'll be able to see all the rules that exist for this product. So we can update that. We go in and we can see that the rule we just created here contains alcohol, it's text, must be 21 to purchase. Then these rules are stored, and then anytime a page loads, when a user would then go to that page, if the rules match the conditions, it's going to inject that blob. So first part, user creating the rules, storing them, those rules then evaluating the product information on the product page and injecting the blob if it needs to be injected. And that's it. You know, if I were to go through and evaluate all of the different choices, in retrospect, I would probably choose it because I think it's pretty cool. But the real reason at the beginning was because the client was already using that. So.
Got it. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
So good job. I'm gonna look, so just so I'm clear, this product is specifically for things like displays. Is that right?
I'm sorry, say it again. Doesn't necessarily have to be a disclaimer, but any sort of information that you want to attach to a product page, mm-hmm. and you want some sort of automation, so it's going to do it across your entire product catalog.
So how do you get around something like, for instance, for SEO? So e-commerce, obviously, one of the main kind of drivers for digital marketers, you know, is SEO. They have to have really great SEO, but duplicate content is a real, it knocks it down. It knocks the site down. So as a site owner, one of the things that I would want to know is this gonna dock me, you know, in my SEO results because I have this duplicated content across? And if it is, how much is it gonna dock me? So
yeah.
That might be something that you want to look at. I would say that we also do some work in Shopify, and what I've seen is that there's a real dearth, like a real lack of very good apps that are fully vetted and don't just have gotchas that you fall into after it's already installed and you're working on it. So you've chosen a good kind of avenue to go down. There's a lot of clients out there that are trying to do websites by themselves and they do
sure.
it in Shopify and with the app. So I would say that that's a really, if you're thinking career-wise, building Shopify apps, I think is actually, it might be a really good idea.
So. I appreciate that. Thanks.
I think I would have liked to see more examples of rules. I think, you know, you gave us the one example. It would have been, and the rule engine creator was very tiny. It was hard to see. So I think you could have jumped straight into, you know, the awesome rules that you could create. So I just added some feedback. Are you caching the data that comes back caching it locally?
That's a great question. Eric, can you just, real quick, because we just started working on this morning.
One of the very next steps is that as you commit a rule when the service that's actually not hosted in the Shopify infrastructure, when it captures that, one of the things that it does is actually takes that rule and publishes it back into Shopify as a static resource, which is then published on the CDN. So while it runs, and you kind of answered your other question about SEO, this solution is running after the initial page response is actually
it's not your caching algorithm, you're just relying on the
wherever we do that inside the Shopify platform, we try to rely as much as possible on Shopify's kind of platform features around how it handles the assets.
So then my last feedback is sort of along the lines of Ben. When I speak, I always try and assume that the audience knows a whole lot more than I do. It just helps me sort of come in with sort of a service attitude. I think in your attempt to let us into your thinking and your development process, which I think was a noble attempt, you gave off a different vibe, which I would just say just a simple rule that you might remember further down the line is just assume that someone in the audience knows a whole hell of a lot more than you do about it. So it just changes the way in which you present, which I think would have maybe shortened the whole thing a little bit.
Sure.
And given you more time to get to the juicy stuff. But, you're obviously also super intelligent and great job.
I appreciate that.
Amen. Okay,
thanks.
Yep.
I'm gonna take this out.
Cool.
Just put it in my pocket.
Oh, sure, that's good. Yeah.
All right, so for this, don't connect your laptop until I get to the slides of demo.
Okay.
And then have that old dashboard view showing. Just have the old dashboard view ready. That'll be the first one, yeah. Perfect. Yeah, and you can put the play on there too.
Yep. 1, 2, 3.
Make sure that works. Okay. So just start whenever I'm ready.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Hey, everybody. My name is Ruben Keyshawn. I worked on the Origin Lounge project. It actually isn't a brand new project. Our whole cohort worked on it for our group project. I just took it from there and worked on the chat, the real-time chat features, and revamped the layout a little bit. So. A little bit about me. I've been doing project management for probably the last 5 years or so, and I really didn't feel like it was a fit for me. I wanted to be more hands-on. A coworker of mine actually recently got laid off. He heard about Origin Code Academy. He started talking to me about it, and kind of a coincidence, I actually ended up getting laid off soon after, and I took that as an opportunity to just jump right into Origin Code Academy, and I have to tell you, it's been the best decision of my life to date. This is clearly what I'm meant to do. Never thought I would figure it out, and I'm really kind of super excited that I finally did figure that out. So really happy to be here. So why Origin Lounge? Well, there was a problem that Origin was having with using Slack. They were the freemium service of Slack wasn't holding on to enough history, so they couldn't access messages or files after about a week. They were just gone. So that was one problem. Another problem was there wasn't really one place that everybody can go to, employees, alumni, students, to get all the relevant information. You know, they had to go to all these different websites or, I don't know, it just didn't have it all conglomerated into one space. And the last problem was, at least for me, it can be difficult when you graduate to keep in touch with alumni and anybody else that you were close with when you were in the program. So what is it? It's basically an interactive internet for Origin employees, students, and alumni, so they can stay connected with one another. And some of the higher level features involved are secure login with session management, role-based views, which means depending on the type of person you are, whether you're an instructor, recruiter, in-house recruiter like Kelly, or an alumni, you'll see a different view of categories. Then there's the chat client, GitHub and LinkedIn integration, which is not quite finished yet, and a markdown editor for employees to go in and create content and post it to the site. This is a brief overview of the technologies that were used, Bootstrap and Angular on the front end. There's actually three servers involved. One is the chat server that has Socket.io running on it. The other is what we call the custom content / chat room API, which was built on ExpressNode and MongoDB. And the last server was something that actually Cameron put together for us, which stored all the users and their roles and all that information so that when you log in, you can check and see what your role is and see all the full list of users that are available and all the roles that are available. So with that, we'll get to the demo. I'll have Sarah helping me out for this demo. Can you put up the view of what the dashboard used to look like? Just want to kind of give you an idea of what it looked like before and what it looks like now. So I'm going to back out of this real quick. Before I jump into that, I'll show you what kind of was my inspiration, what we were kind of going for. I don't know how many people use Glip in the room. Does anybody use Glip? All right. Well, this is kind of what I was aiming for, with the panel on the left, the calendar in the middle, and then all these different categories. And what I came up with was something like this. Now it's going to take a little while, I guess, for it to show all the content on the right. There you go. So what you see here is you have on the right all the custom categories depending on what type of role the user is. This is an alumni, so these should be relevant to an alumni. Code tests, technical interview prep, hiring companies, so on. Everybody sees the calendar. They can change the view of the calendar from month view to day view. And on the far left side, you see all the chat room information, the channels that they're a part of, and so on. So the way I'm going to approach the rest of the demo is I'm kind of going to just create a scenario where I am an alumni, and I want to reach out to the in-house technical recruiter. Sarah will be the technical recruiter, and I'll be somebody that's already working at a company, already landed a job. And I want to inform her of a position that's opened up at our company and ask her if she has anybody that she thinks can fit that position. So, Sarah, if you could log in. When Sarah logs in as a recruiter, an in-house recruiter, you'll see a different view.
Oh. Very different.
Very different, huh? Are you connected to the Wi-Fi? Yeah. Okay.
Which one is it?
It's
Yeah, it needs Wi-Fi because what I neglected to mention was that all those servers that I mentioned, they're hosted on Heroku, so she needs to connect up there. It's in Slack. So hold on. Thanks, Ken. So once it connects, we'll get that up and running. Probably because the gulp serve stopped. Go into the origin lounge folder. Now gulp serve. Okay, now try to log in as placement. Okay, there you go. So you can see that her categories are slightly different. There are some that are the same. You have the GitHub, LinkedIn, but she also has managed content, managed categories. Those are more admin type features. Can you click on manage content real quick? So here is a way for an admin type user to go in and create new content. So if you can, just select any of those wikis, type in just title, just to show. And you can see a preview on the bottom here. And then go ahead and add like a list over here. Just click on list and just start. Just, that's fine, that's good enough right there. So they can go ahead and add in all this content. And then you would just click on submit over here. And it would let you know you added new content to the wikis category. Now if she had a wikis category here, we could click on there and see that it was added. But what we can show you is that click on announcements. There you can see somebody had created an announcement called Demo Day. And if you click on Demo Day, it'll show you information. Now there's a bug there with it not showing the actual markdown version and too big, but that's beside the point. So back to the demo, if I were an alumni and I wanted to let the recruiter know, hey, I have a job posting here. Do you have anybody that can fit this need? I would go ahead and start a new chat message and select placement here. And when I click go, it'll kick me to the new chat room, and she will see the new chat room as well. Now, Sarah, if you can go to one of the other chat rooms, and if she's in another chat room and I go ahead and on my screen, for example, want to say, hey, Sarah, TGIF, and put a little emoji here, smiley face, and hit send. She'll see, it's kind of hard to tell, but this lights up. I want to make it light up more so you really know there's something new there. She can click in there and she'll see the message. And I can go here and basically say, know of anyone in your current cohort that's an angular star. I know of an opening at my company and wanted to see if you had anyone in mind. And so Sarah would go ahead and respond and send on over a resume. And what I'll show you here on my screen is the information over here showing you the users and files. When she sends that file, I see the file in the chat message and I see it in the list of files over here. And I can go ahead and download it by clicking over here or actually even on the icon itself. So if I click on that, it downloads the file. I could open it up and there's her resume. One other feature that I added in here was Giphy support. So if you type in slash Giphy, like in Slack, and I just put in like TGIF, it'll pull a random image that's supposed to be relevant to what we did, what we typed. Giphy support wasn't too difficult. It was just a very basic API that you pass a string and it gives you a randomized result based on that.
Emojis wasn't difficult either. It was just an Angular package you have to find online and figure out how to implement that on the HTML and filter it so it shows up as an actual emoji on in the chat screen. The last thing I guess I can show is that, Sarah, if you can log off, just show that you can see on my screen over here who's logged in. When she logs off, it just basically shows that she's now not online. And that's pretty much it. Yep. That's what I was inspired by. That's what Origin was looking to do, create a Slack version that would actually be able to keep all the chat history and not lose it.
Did you implement some sort of search function as well?
That's what I was hoping to get to, but I didn't have enough time. Yeah.
What is the significance of the categories?
The categories are supposed to be tailored towards the type of user that you are. So if you are an alumni who's just graduated, for example, you could, for example, go here and see, there's none here right now, but you can go here and see all the code tests that maybe instructors wanted to provide to you so you have them all in one area, you know, instead of looking around on the web to find examples of code tests. It's just one example.
So is it sort of the tag that goes across documents, chats, commits?
Actually, no. It's in on the back end, you have a categories table, you have a content table, and in that content, and then you have a categories content table, which is a junction table, that basically says, if you create a piece of content for this category, assign it to that category, so that when you pull all those pieces of content that are relevant, it'll find it in the database and display it.
The only feedback I would give is try and make it as fun as possible. I know this is just a demo, and I know it's early days, but I would keep in mind that part of Slack's allure is the fun colors, the little motivational phrase every day. It just makes you feel, okay, this isn't heavy. Yeah. When I look at that, I feel like I'm in Confluence or Asana or something.
I've used those, yeah.
It feels like a JOB. So I think Origin now is a brilliant idea. A little piece of me dies every time I see something like this because so many thousands of organizations are recreating this exact thing for their walled gardens. Mm-hmm. But I think it's a brilliant idea for Origin. I would just really focus on FUN because when that alumni is, you know, 2-3 years down the line and they have to come back and manage projects, it's going to suck. So just, you know, that's my feedback.
Okay.
Drives me nuts. I think I use Slack as some of my filing system. So if, you know, a week later, a week and a day later, I go back and it's not there, it's stupid. one of the things I would like to have seen the answer to is, so you were solving for the freemium version of Slack that erases messages after a week. Mm-hmm. You know, the reason it does that, obviously, is, you know, server size, that kind of thing. We noticed, I sent an email to my colleague a couple days ago, or a week ago or so, that something like last week, Slack sent us a message saying last week you had something like 150,000 messages on Slack. So a company like mine, we talk a lot on Slack, we use it. So I would love for it not to erase every week, so I would love to have something like this that keeps it. But then I know my tech guys are going to say, yeah, but what about the database size? What about the server size? How are we
exactly
expunging stuff that doesn't matter, et cetera, et cetera. So I would have loved to have seen how you're dealing with that. You know, the kind of the dark side of, okay, now we have all this data, but how are we caching it, or are we caching it? How are we storing it? How are we getting rid of the stuff? How, you know, like that.
And that's actually a conversation I had with Sean when I was working on this project. I was saying, yeah, it's all nice to say that you can store as much data as you want, but the reality is you can't. So you need to put in a feature to be able to create a reasonable threshold, something more reasonable than a week. Yeah, so I totally understand that.
Did you implement the entire chat functionality with Socket.io
back into a chat a week later and see the message in the chat for second slot.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
All right. Thanks, Sarah.
Check.
All right. Hi, everybody. Thank you for being here. We are Team Musilist.
All right, guys. So a little bit about myself. I'm born and raised in San Diego. I attended college at San Diego State, received a bachelor's in statistics. Now, my real change came when I graduated college. Didn't have a direction, was basically stuck, but I knew that I wanted to keep challenging myself, learning, and creating. And that's when I came across Origin Code Academy. And that's where I felt like I could develop my skills and be able to learn a lot of new stuff. So coming into this class, didn't know that much. Very little knowledge, but now today, standing right here in front of you guys, feel really, really confident in my skill set, and nowadays I am able to create Ionic mobile apps and much more.
Hi, everybody. I'm Jesse Friedner. I moved to San Diego from Palm Springs. Prior to this, I was actually a motocross dirt bike racer and an automotive technician. Straight out of high school, I got hired as a mechanic. Did that for about the past 5 years. Enjoyed it, but knew it wasn't what I wanted to do. I always wanted to work with software. Last year, I got injured pretty badly, and while I was down, I needed a way to channel my energy, so I found coding. I always knew I wanted to do it. Started self-teaching myself, found Origin Code Academy, and knew it's where I wanted to be, and now that I'm here, I can create mobile applications, web applications. It's been a great experience, so I'm loving it.
So what is Musilist? In fact, we know that for a local musician, it's pretty difficult to find a local band that could bring out the best of them. So what Musilist did in 2003, they created a website where it connects tens of thousands of people all around the world. And this website showcases local music, local DJs, and local musicians. Oh, what did it say? Yeah. And then it showcases all that. So imagine in your morning commute. You'll be able to listen to amazing local music instead of that mainstream radio. And then the reason we ended up working on this is because me and Jesse believed in the idea of exposing and connecting local musicians. And I'm pretty sure there's a podcast show on this website that you guys will enjoy the music and will want to know more information about that. And this is where Jesse steps in.
So yeah, here's the website that they had built. They've built this a few years ago. This is what they have been working with now to connect local bands and musicians to users. This is the technology we use to build a mobile application where we can stream the audio, and a user is going to be able to bookmark any song they like that they can hear. So what we did is we used HTML5, JavaScript, and CS3. CSS was for all the styling. Ionic is what it was built on, and that's how we're able to use it on a mobile application. With Ionic, you can do all the same code you would do for a web app, and you can use it for an Android or iOS. We used Angular for all the functionality, so all the functionality you see was built with Angular. Entity Framework, Microsoft SQL Server for the back end, that's what the API was built with. That's how we get all the data we need. And we use the Cordova Media plugin to actually stream all the audio you're hearing. And with that, let's get to our app.
So here's a login page. Imagine being able to log in. Say you wanted to hear a new song, new artist. You know, I've been stuck listening to the same bands, not being able to find anything new. With this, you can log in. Say you're driving to work, your daily commute. You want to hear some new songs. Go ahead and log in. It's going to bring you to this.
My bad.
It's going to bring you to this homepage here. Here's a list of a few of the podcasts MusicList has put out. And in these podcasts, what they do is they stream local bands, local artists, DJs, anything local is streamed. And you can find new music. You can go in, say you wanted to hear podcast 139. Go ahead and click in there. Brings you to your own little media player. Nice little layout. You can hit start podcast. And what it's doing is it's pulling in the one long MP3 file. Now, what a podcast is it's one long MP3 file with about 10 to 20 songs in it. Usually, you're not going to know what song is playing because it's one long MP3 file with the DJ talking and many songs playing through it. With this, you can literally hit that bookmark button and it will shoot it to your library. So say, do you guys like this song? Sound pretty good? A little guitar, a little nice beat. Would any of you know who this band is? No one could tell me, right? All right, so go ahead and hit the pause button. Close that out, say, okay, we didn't want to hear that anymore, but we did like that song, so we hit that bookmark button. You can go to 175, say, oh, I want to hear something else they put out. Let's see what they have in podcast 175. Hit start podcast. And now this technology has the ability to stream MP3s and M4As. MP3s do stream a little quicker. We found when we're streaming the M4s, it takes a little bit longer to bring it in. But here you go. Streaming starts up. Say, okay, you know, I kind of like this song. Let's see. Let's listen to it a little bit longer. May or may not like it. All right, sounds good. Let's hit that bookmark button. Let's see who this user is. I don't know who it is. Do any of you know who this band is? Ever heard this song before? So we can pause that out. Close it. We can open up our library. Technical difficulty. Sorry, guys. So we are having a bit of a technical difficulty here. Sorry, everybody.
Get the screenshots.
Need to reload it. Need to reload the whole app. Sorry, everybody. We're launched. We have it in a actual emulator, and that's the way that we are able to show the Android phone come up, and it needs to actually have live reload going. And it looks like it timed out on us. So just let me launch it up real quick for you guys. Sorry about this. Like I said, we're using an actual Ionic emulator. So what that emulator does is it kicks up an actual phone. We had to download the Android SDK and everything into it, and that's what kicks it up and is able to give us all the nice view. Otherwise, if you just serve it up in the normal web view, you don't get any of the key features that we have added in. So it does take just a quick second to launch up, unfortunately. This is unfortunate that this happened here. But what we were going to show you when we did that is that you can take any song that you would not know who that artist or user was, you can press that bookmark button, it's going to take it into your library, and it's going to show you, because chances are you're not going to know what artist was playing. You're not going to know the name of the song. Now you, with this app, all you would have to do is press that button, and it shows you. I really would like to show in action.
I really would love to show you guys this, so bear with me here. Yeah, there's some of the things that come with software. So I can kind of just show you a little bit about more about this. So
here we go, it's launching up.
So we have our phone launching up. Bringing up our emulator, giving us a phone. Yeah, Android are a little bit slow. Sorry, it takes a little while to boot up. Yeah, we got to start. Yeah, so with these Android emulators, after not being used for a while, they time out on us and the code just stops running. So I believe that is what happened. Should have done an iPhone, maybe it would have been a little faster, but the beauty with Ionic, actually, the way we have it's an Ionic framework, is this can be used in an Android or an iPhone. So we chose to do Android because we both have Androids. Looks like that was a mistake, but now we're up. Now it's up and going. Now it's launched. Now we can show you what I wanted to show you. So just give the app a little quick second here. Here we go. Okay, we're back. So, library is empty. Say now that we got our phone died, now we have it charged again. Now we have it booted back up. It has battery in it. Say, I really wanted to know who that artist was. My phone died on me, and now I don't know who that artist was that I was listening to. I love this song, but so now when the song starts, we're going to be able to hit this bookmark button. It's going to show you. This is our nice little intro, you know. If you hit bookmark, it wouldn't do anything yet. So now you can hit bookmark. You can pause the song. The code's broken.
Oh, did it though.
There's the song. There it is. Fast Romantics by Julia. There we go. So I would have showed you guys that we can do it with multiple songs. You can go in any podcast, and it would, I think if you click 175, the song starts right up. Just bear with me. It's really cool. We're really happy that we're able to get this functioning because, actually, no, you know what? Let's just stop it right now. We're really happy we're able to get this built because the thing that's just so awesome about it is these songs, it's all local artists playing. You're not going to know what song is playing, so anytime you hit that bookmark button, you're going to be able to go into this library.
Click.
You can build up your library of all these great local musicians and local artists you have never known about. So that other one that I was playing, I had the media down, but see again, there it works. It grabs the song in one MP3 file with multiple songs in it. It's able to go through, find what song is playing, and shoot it into your library so it can give you all the information of that artist and song. And that is the demo of our app.
So, great job, guys. I have to say, as engineers, your life is going to be consumed by technical difficulties. So, I have a couple, well, I have a question first. So, MusoList has an open API that you use? Is that
no, we're actually pulling from we have JSON created. It has the MP3 for the podcast, for each podcast. It has the MP3 in it, and it has all of the info for the title, the song, you know, the artist name. It has all that info in the JSON we're pulling from. So we're not using the MusoList API. We have our own, basically, API that we're pulling from.
I understand. Okay. So then my one real question is, why didn't you just use that white space on the screen, on the play screen? Show who the artist was. You know, why are you making the user go one more step beyond the screen they're already on?
why didn't it have the name and artist list right there as it's playing? That would be a great feature we could definitely add in there. For right now, we really just wanted to give the artist the ability to build a library of bookmarked songs that they love. You know, we want them to be able to go into that library anytime they would like and say, oh yeah, I love that song. I didn't know who that was, but you know, now I do because I have that bookmark button, you know, so. But
I would say the value of the app right now as it stands in this feature set is that the ability to build a library, not so much new, because if I were solving for, you know, who's this artist, I would put it in this white spot. But if I was solving for how can I keep a list of things that I love, then I would put in the library like you guys did. But anyway, just a suggestion.
Yeah, no, that's definitely a great feature that we would love to have. So in the JSON file, each MP3 has playlists, and in that it has the song name, artist title in there, and it has and so there's a start time of each song and an end time of each song. So what's cool about the technology is that it grabs, you know, if it's playing and the DJ's talking, it won't do anything at all because there's no MP3, there's no audio for it to grab. So we have it set so as the song is playing, as the one long MP3 is playing, you know, the podcast. It's going through because we have the start time and end time of each song. So it's grabbing it. When that song starts, it's grabbing the song name, and the artist title, and we're able to shoot it into that library.
Good job. Thanks.
What was it like working with the guys who...
They're very, very, very helpful. Actually, it was a great experience. We got a real-world experience. The CTO we built this for, guy right here at TN up front, he's a great guy, actually. I gotta say, he's amazing. I mean, he's a busy man. He's a real busy man, but he would take times out of his days to come into our classroom, have a whiteboard session, lay out, you know, what he wanted built, the key features he wanted built, and he's just very thorough, you know, gave us a good explanation of the technology he wanted, and he was passionate about it like we are. We love music, local bands, local artists, and that's what this really is aimed for, is just connecting users to local music. And, you know, being able to build up a library of a list of songs you never would have known what the song name was or who the artist was, and now you can because you'll have a library of it all. So.
Very good. Two things. Yes, that is my project. So I told Jeff, but Jeff said I can be on the panel. The true CTO is sitting in the back there, Rob Kaufman. So you guys haven't met him because he chose not to meet him. the big technology for us behind this was annotating podcasts. But you know, although you can chapter MP3s in certain technologies, we wanted to find some sort of standard where you can annotate podcasts to the point where, given a long 30-minute or 2-hour MP3, is there a way to just build that annotation around it as a tool? Super applicable in the muserless project to add build your library, but we're also exploring whether this could be some sort of open standard for annotating podcasts. So I think you guys are incredible. By far my favorites of everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Got it. Thanks to everyone for getting through me with those technical difficulties.
Oh, this. It's still playing?
Did I kind of do all right with that save when the technology broke?
Yeah, you saved yourself.
Let me get the remote.
Yeah, you don't
want
to fall
over. Oh, man, dude, it's...
All right.
You guys are both off of mute, so you're both on.
What's up?
Testing 1, 2, 1, 2. Is it even on?
Why yeah, is we're on. We're live. Check, check.
Check, 2, 1, 2. Is mine not on? Hello?
There we go.
Now, okay.
You need to plug in the computer.
Yes. Is it good?
Check.
Yeah, great. All right, let me actually just.
You're good.
Okay.
Good?
I'll be,
We're good?
Yeah, we're good.
All right. All right. So our project is called Phun Connection. My name is Matt Torkelson. This is...
I'm Hajir Mashiri.
So a little bit about ourselves. I have a bachelor's degree in economics. For predominantly most of my life, I spent in finance. Last 5 years, I worked for the Vanguard Group. It's not something I was very passionate about. I spent most of my life in it, so I was pretty good at it. I knew what I was doing. But it's not something I saw doing for the rest of my life. I have a passion, though, for math and art. And with different colleagues over the years, I had discussions over what the next 20 years are going to be like in business. And what kept coming up was that businesses are going more towards having some sort of knowledge, no matter where you are in the company, of development or coding. So it just seemed like a natural fit. At least to get some sort of knowledge of that going forward. I had a few friends of mine that have done boot camps in the past and turned out that they loved it and have had successful careers so far. So that's why I joined Origin.
Again, my name is Hajir, if you didn't get that the first time. Yes, before this, I was actually an assistant for an attorney. And I worked there for a few years. Was very interesting. It just wasn't the right fit. Didn't want to be something I want to be doing in the future. I felt like I needed to find the right career path. So my brother actually had suggested when I was a kid, I was kind of working with HTML, doing little web apps on like Angel Fire and, you know, I think it was Tripod. So anyways, he was like, dude, you know, you still build websites. Why don't you look into that? Try to find something, and I did some research, and I came across Origin Code Academy. And just to let you guys know, it was probably the best experience of my life. And you know what's funny is my brother today, he actually told me, he's like, you know what? He said, on my birthday, so on my brother's birthday, it's going to be the most important day of my life. So I kind of like put it together thinking, and I'm like, oh, demo day is my brother's birthday. So, yeah.
And this app is for him. raise of hands, who has had a problematic experience with attorneys throughout the years? Okay. And those experiences probably wasted a lot of your time and money, something you wanted to get back or spend in a different fashion. I would assume that. So that was where we came up with a solution to create a seamless and interactive relationship between the client and attorney on a more simplified ground than what our current client was using. Right now he's using an application called MyCase. The issue at hand was it was very complicated and a lot more was on the page than was actually needed or that the client needed to see. So that's where we were brought on board to create a more simplified application.
Yeah, and just to touch up on that, we definitely talked to multiple, attorneys and firms. and they all kind of had the same issue. And so we were thinking, you know, Slack has all these features that half, more than half aren't even being used, so why not take that and really just, like, you know, put an engine in there and just make it, like, a lot better and user-friendlier. So, Matt, you want to just go?
So main technologies we used was MeanStack, so Mongo, Express, Node, and Angular. Front end was HTML and CSS. We used Passport for the authentication, and we integrated Facebook and Google logins into the application as well.
Oh, and we did use IntelliJ. I figured as a, you know, like a text editor, I think IntelliJ was very helpful, especially for a big project that we had. And this is still an ongoing project. And, you know, we kind of had about, I'd say about less than a month to really start working on the project and get things done. And you know how clients usually are. They want more than what, you know, in a small period of time. But so this is actually, we're going to start off on the main page. We got to build a firm app, right? I mean, a website. Otherwise, you know, like, how are they going to know about the website? It's not there. So we started off, we got Machine Law Firm, got a picture from the background, and if you want to go to About the Attorney, so just a little about my brother. I'm not going to brag about him, but, you know, it's just plain and simple. He's, you know, talks about a little bit of his past, what he's doing. If you want to click on Practice Areas, and this is all CSS, HTML, a little bit of Bootstrap, you know, just kind of implemented everything. Font awesome. It's definitely awesome because I got the phone there. Got the credit card over there. And then we got a little hospital there because the firm actually deals with credit debt issues, personal injuries, and unwanted phone calls. So in case, by the way, if anyone has those issues, more than welcome. Okay? Click on contact us. And there you go. If you need contact information, I'll be available after this too. So you can come to me. More than happy. Click on the login. So this is where our app kind of like just, you know, really takes off. So OAuth 2.0 is all what I would say. Definitely did research on that. Passport, it's like the new thing and like everyone is doing it. So I'm like, well, I got to keep up with technology. And Matt and I decided, you know what, we got to get this OAuth authentication. Google, Facebook are the two main ones, obviously. Could add Twitter and all that, but we said, let's try two first. Let's get it going, and we can always build on. So if you hit the Google, now, okay.
What did I do?
I don't know.
It's resolving us right now.
It's probably a Wi-Fi situation here. Definitely not us. So, I don't know who's, you know.
Do you want to just log into your Facebook?
Yeah, it's definitely Wi-Fi. So, let's do this. Oh, what is this? Oh, you click dictionary. Maybe that's. Alright, so let's do this. Really, the most amazing part is. Okay. I believe so. Yeah.
Now try it. Is all our servers up there?
Yeah.
Try just registering.
So, gotta be kidding me. Okay. This works. Okay, just having a little bit of issues there. Sorry. Seems to be a common thing going around. Wi-Fi is down? It's all right. Just, guess.
Screenshots of everything? Hmm? Did you do screenshots?
No.
You guys have slides?
No, we can't. I would say no. I have a screenshot.
Create a hotspot.
Okay, well, let's just log in. You know what, actually, let's do
yeah.
this.
Yeah.
Hey,
look,
who's
it? Bye.
Thank you.
Okay. That's the thing in the password. That's the password.
That's the password?
Ellis.
That's the password.
Okay, give me 1 second. Let me just reach out to this. Oh.
There we go.
Oh, okay, wait. We got to log out. We'll go. All right, we got it going. Yay. Okay. All
right.
Okay, so back to the app. So if you hit Google, authentication, pretty secured. It's a law firm. They don't want to get sued, obviously. So go ahead and put in my password, which we will change. Let's put that in, I guess.
So much trust here.
Okay, so I put in my password, use Google, authenticates. Now we're logged into the app. Don't have notification, don't have any recent activity, click on cases, and don't have any ongoing cases. Now, next step, documents. So this is where we set up on the back end using Mongo with the database table. We set up a system, a GridFS system, so it allows you to store files in chunks where it's pretty fast, I would say. Now we're able to retrieve, post, and retrieve, so you know, requesting and all the files that are in the database to be able to post it, and it goes in the database, and then we're able to track that out and be able to download it. So if you hit, for example, we have a few lists here, probably November bill, December, so like John Doe versus Chase, we can go ahead and download it, and there it is, goes straight to my computer, with the file name and everything. We can go on the add a document. And by the way, we logged in as a client user with Google and Facebook. You're logging in as a client. We also have the attorney section, which we'll show you right after. So here, the client is here. You know, they have a bunch of documents that the attorney could have possibly sent them. And so they want to download it, retrieve the file, and then be able to look over the file. You know, maybe they need to look over it for their hearing that's coming up, and so on. And then if that's the case, the attorney would be able, yeah, you can go ahead and sort of tell you. It's probably a toaster framework we can add later. Then you can go to messages. And so it adds it all automatically on the bottom over there on the list. If you go to messages, markdown, earlier one of our colleagues talked about the markdown editor, so I don't really want to get into that. But you can, you know, there's a drop down there, and went from the back server to grab all the attorneys, and it'll input it there, do this thing, so it only, like, you know, pulls out one, because you don't want multiple same attorney names. Same goes for the practice area. Hit the submit button, it would technically clear everything and tell you it's all good. And then account settings is just, you know, your information, you want to update it. Go ahead and log out, and let's do the attorney side. So as an attorney, obviously, you want to be able to log in, add cases, you know, see the list of your clients, and then be able to post or send messages, retrieve messages that are given to you from the clients. So, again, you know, this was for a month for what we did is this is what we came up with. So it's definitely an ongoing project. I'm definitely, and I know Matt is as well, we're both going to be continue working on this.
What's
just put Alex.
Not bad.
Yep, so that works as well. Okay, so recent activity, looks like he added some cases. So we got the case name, you know, we got what, Hugo versus Equifax, probably identity theft. Yep, okay, attorney assigned. So there are more than one attorney that could be assigned to the case. If you hit the cases, you can go ahead and add cases. So on this situation, again, it was kind of like the markdown where we retrieved this from the back end. So then it has the attorney that you want to assign to the case, and which practice area it is, and those are drop-down options. So we can go ahead, and if you notice before you hit the send, or add case, if you scroll down a little bit. Okay, so last one obviously was John Dover. Okay, so go ahead and add case. Oh, wait, did you do that already?
Yep.
Okay,
just
so yeah,
one.
Just adds it on the bottom, clears your form, and you know it'll tell you like, hey, you just add the case. That's all his login information. And then if you hit, let's see, documents, same thing, same situation as the client side, able to retrieve, download, and also send documents. And if you go to messaging, okay, so I guess that part didn't get. Okay, so eventually this will be all set up. These are things that, with time, obviously, something that's ongoing. We're going to continue working on it and really get it fixed. So I am open to hear your suggestions, obviously. So, yeah, that's basically our app. So, again, going over it, it's a client with attorney, you know, being able to communicate with one another, sending documents back and forth, messages in case, you know, like the client wants to know about a hearing case and they forgot the date, they can just go online and check it instead of sitting there 30 minutes on their lunch break, calling the attorney, trying to get old and like, hey, what time is my hearing again? What am I supposed to wear? They can just send a message while having their, you know, hamburger or something and wait for the answer. So, yeah.
Feedback?
Do you send notices to, I'm going to test this, do you send email notices to clients?
Yes, so email is something we will interpret into the app. When a client signs up, which actually there's a register page, so when the client signs up, they're going to get an email validation to, hey, confirm, you know, that it's their email. So we'll do an email validation. They'll hit the, you know, confirm link, and then it'll be registered. So it'll send to the database, and once they actually hit the link, then they're registered and they're able to log in. So that's a system that we are definitely putting or planning on putting in. And, yeah.
So. Yeah, I think it's great. You know, there are organizations like Appfolio out there that do just this. But I think I love how, you know, it's obviously someone who means a lot to you that you built an app for, which I can tell there's a lot of care in you. So I think it's great.
Thank you. Yeah, and I think, the thing is when I was at the, you know, working for in the law firm industry, and Matt, actually, his sister's a lawyer as well, and she had said, you know, this is an ongoing situation where they're having issues with, you know, really communicating with clients. And this is from San Diego. We spoke to about 6-7 different lawyers. Same issue. So why not, you know, solve their problem?
So these lawyers want all their clients emailing them?
Well, they – well, again, it's a project that, you know, it's definitely being built upon. We're going to continue building on it. But essentially, it'll be so that, you know, we have a whole online system of a client and attorney.
Yeah, that's great.
Great job, guys. How are you handling the security with this? Like, how do you handle security both in terms of the data, the documents, but then also, for instance, me as a client, how do you know it's me that's logging into me and my Google account? Have you thought about that?
JWT is assigned to you locally when you log in through your credentials. So you're verified against the back end that you are who you say you are. And then...
Then I am... So Ben, if my computer were open and that screen was open, could you hit login and it would give me my credentials for email? Or no? Is that
JWT? I mean, potentially, yes.
So you're... Can you rephrase your question for me, please?
So I'm thinking as a person who's hired an attorney...
Okay. Okay.
So if I ever say in my Gmail account, you know, I say passwords on my computer and all the rest of it. So I want to make sure that, say, you know, EdX or something like that couldn't, by knowing my username and password and knowing that I'm working with an attorney, be able to log in, you know.
Well, unless they have your password. Okay.
Well, that's what I'm saying. So Okay. So my suggestion would be something like two-step verification,
okay,
like a text or something, mm-hmm, so that you can actually verify that it is that person who's logging in, and maybe just for the first time, maybe it's something that a person in their life, they're not really worried about it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just thinking with attorneys come along when...
Oh, yeah.
Sure.
And this is definitely the first step, at least to, you know, have Facebook and Google kind of involved as far as the security goes. I actually noticed on Facebook, they're pretty damn secure. So, you know, their system, I'm starting to look into that, and I want to kind of like take what they have, you know, and throw it into this app so it is more secured. Definitely something that is, the whole security issue, yeah, that's going to be an issue and that we're going to solve as well. Because I know... So besides the fact that he probably calls me every other day nagging me about the setup, it is something where I told him like, hey, you know, like this is something that is a long process, but we are planning on build on it. So as you know, him being a client, I have to really, really know what his problem is. You know, he's telling me 100 different problems, but I'm like, okay, there's always 99 problems, right? But we need to really focus on, what the main issues are and be able to go in there and solve it. And then I'll have them test it. I'll have them, like, maybe go through the app, make sure it's user-friendly as possible. And that way, you know, if that kind of answers your question.
Does he have an app you can use right now? Is he using it
now? This isn't necessarily live yet because he's super picky, and I'm sure all clients are. Yes, so I'm not going to, you know, post this live unless I get the clients okay. You know, you always want to make sure the client's satisfied. And I'm pretty sure he'll look at this, but personally he'll be like, wow, this is great, what you and Matt build. But, you know, essentially we're going to have to really make it more, you know, more, I guess I would say, presentable for it to be live. Yeah.
In addition to that, it's just... like you brought up with the security features, it's just not ready for a live back and forth between a client and attorney,
yeah,
especially with the you know, that sort of relationship. It's not prepped yet, and you know, 3 weeks is a short amount of time to get something like this completed. So next iteration, that may be where it goes live. Maybe it's another two down the line.
I mean, this is our final project, so technically it's like a, well, we'll see, you know. Salary talks are more confidential, but, you know. Thank you.
So I've done work in this space in the past. I've worked on apps like this. What is your biggest differentiator, your key differentiator between you and your competition?
Well, the difference would be that the competition that we have are, their apps aren't as user-friendly, and there's so many features where half of those features, my brother tells me, like, dude, there's so much content and stuff going on, like, sometimes I don't even know where to go to add a case. I'm like, well, you must really not be computer savvy, but that's fine. You know, so I really thought about it, and I talked to Matt about it as well. I'm like, we just need to, like, really, as I mentioned earlier, like, just take what that, like, you know, what our competitors have with so much other information, take what the lawyers use the most and really make it as user-friendly and even more secure and even more, like, you know, just, like, a bigger, you know, like, being able to retrieve data. That's one thing that the competitors, as you know, you have to have a sign-up and all that. Once you're no longer paying them, they're also no longer giving you any of the information. So that's another thing, that we have it all stored in the database, whatever, so we can have that feature where, hey, you know, you're no longer with us, but we're able to give you information, just pay me a little cash on the side, but, you know, so yeah. So. That's yeah. Sorry, I didn't want to, like,
no, it's cool.
Are you announcing that the shot round's on you?
No.
Oh, just kidding.
Huh? Okay, that was the last project. So in just a couple minutes, we'll actually go upstairs. And I know the beer's upstairs. I think the pizza. I think the pizza will be. It's the pizza's got it. Everything's upstairs and ready to go. So first, I want to thank not just the students, but either parents, spouses, brothers, sisters, right? Like, without them dedicating all of their time in this class, which they had very little free time, I'm sure their significant others probably despise them and origin a little bit. So I just want to thank everybody that contributed to the success of the students and their families. So I just want to clap for them. And also, I want to thank the panelists. We have swag for you from Team Phun, actually. So we're like, yeah. So thanks for your guys' feedback. And also, I want to give a special round of applause also to Sean. This was actually the first time that he had to, we used a significant amount of real-world projects. So he was the project manager for like 7 projects that were all due the exact same day. So he was a little stressed, so. And finally, I know there was a like severe camera crew in here earlier, so that was actually CNBC. So if you guys want to see yourself, I think it'll be like Monday power lunch-ish. So trying to get some of you famous for showing up, so we appreciate that. And yeah, so as soon as he's done, we'll go straight up to the 11th floor. If you want to talk to the team, you'll see the flyers by each of their tables. And again, thanks for coming out. So it's all you, Sean.
Next, Tristan Ewing.
Good job, Tristan. Jesse Friedner. Good job. Joseph Kalp. Reuven Kishan. Benny Largo. Next up, Jeffrey K. Laumer. Hajir Mashiri. Bahman Sadiq. Marcy A. Tarpey. Matt Torkelson. Finally, Victor Manuel Centejas, Jr. Okay, one more. Cameron Wilcox, please come up. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Right.
Thank you so much, guys. Thank you, guys.
Yeah.
11th floor for refreshments and questions. Come on up.
You guys. Good job. Good job.